is a place where mercy reigns and never dies. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide, where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, at the cross, I surrender.
www.cornerstoneofadrian.com. You're going to see some really cool tabs up here at the top. There's some options in here. YouTube, if you go to the YouTube button there, you're going to see all the latest videos that we've been posting on YouTube. It's updated weekly, two or three times a week. So check it out if you've missed any of the services. There's another tab here called prayer. Now listen, we've had some people that have went on there and filled out the forms. Again, that goes, as soon as you hit submit, it goes right to all the elders of the church who begin to pray for that. We've actually had some people using that. We've actually even had some people that have, when they've had the elders in agreement, like James says to do, they've actually experienced miracles. Go figure. That when we pray, when we gather together in Jesus' name, that there's power present there, that miracles actually take place. We've actually had some people getting answers to prayer. Go figure. The word works. Amen. So check out the prayer tab if you've got some things that just praying for. The other thing we want to talk about is the giving tab. I'm going to go ahead and click on there. Under the giving tab, you'll see another page come up here where there's some options where you can begin to put in some information if you want to give your tithe and your offerings to the church. In there, there's a drop-down menu that when you click on the drop-down menu, there's some different options that you can choose from. Specifically, there is like the VBS. Now listen, we've been doing streaming church now for a few weeks, but understand this. This is not our permanent address. There will be a time in our very near future, but we will be gathered in the house of the Lord again. There will be singing, there will be dancing, there will be victory in the house of the Lord, and we will celebrate on the way there. Now listen, because of that, we have plans. VBS is still going to happen this year. So one of the options in that drop-down menu is where you can go and you can give into the VBS fund. So that's coming up. Another thing that's there is the firework fund. Every year, every July 4th, we do a big firework display out here, and we attract people from all over the city. We had people pulling in the bank parking lot last year over here and was watching the firework display. They did an amazing job. Bob Hoyle and all those guys back there that was helping with that, they did a great job. It's going to happen again this year. Well, fireworks aren't cheap. Come on now. So there's a fund there that we can give into that. Some other options to give is the carpet. You know, we've got carpet laying down here in this sanctuary that's going to be glued down very soon. We still owe about $4,000 on this carpet. So there's some opportunities. Again, we're just talking about ways that you can give. We have other things that we do. You know, we support Fishes and Loaves and other ministries here in this town. So there's a mission fund that you can give into. There's a youth fund. Of course, tithes and offering. Now listen, I want to read a verse that's talking about that. In Hebrews 7, verse 8, it says, "Here, mortal men receive the tithe." That's talking about really myself, the other pastors, in-house pastors here, the other gifts, Ephesians 4 gifts that are here. We receive the tithes, but it says, "But there," talking about in heaven, "he receives them." Let me read that again. "Here, mortal men receive the tithe, but there," he, talking about our high priest in heaven, "Jesus receives them." So I think it's important to point out from the Word of God that when you bring your tithe here, you're not giving your tithe to Pastor Bill. Pastor Bill's going to take it from your hand. Pastor Bill's going to process it. Our team's going to process it. But you need to understand, you're not giving that to me. You're not giving it to the church here, like physically this building. Here, listen, you're removing the holy tithe from your house. You're worshiping the Lord with your tithe. You're bringing it into the storehouse. Here, we're receiving it. But here, we're receiving it. There, he's getting it. You understand what I'm saying? You're giving this to the Lord. And he's going to bless you as a result of it. So listen, we're giving you some opportunities to give. We already talked about the website. You can go to your Android store or your iPhone app store, wherever you get your apps from. Go check out the one called Church Center app. When you download this app, you get it installed. Put in your zip code there. It's going to search for churches in your area that are using this app. Find our logo, Cornerstone Church. Install the app. You'll be able to give right there on the app. It's simple to do once you have it set up. I mean, you literally just put in an amount and hit go. You can also text to give. So the phone number, if you could say it that way, of who you would be giving to is 84321. 84321, and we'll give you the where you're going to send, and then just put any amount and you hit go. And it's going to take you right to the same place as some other instructions. Of course, you can still mail a check, P.O. Box 247, Onsted, Michigan, 49265. Amen. Listen, I'm glad to be here. I'm glad you're with us. And I'm going to ask you to do something. You're on your Facebook app right now watching us. I'd like for you to click like. I'd like for you to click share. I'd also like for you to click check in. Where's it going to check you into? Again, you can look, when you hit check in, it's going to take you to a place where you can put in search for Cornerstone Church. Check into the church right now. Share that thing. Like it so that every time you do that, it's spreading this thing out further. Last Sunday, I think we had over 500 or 600 people that was watching that had viewed this video stream at one point or another. How's that happening? Because every time somebody's liking it, every time somebody's sharing it, out further and further. Amen. So let's do this. Let's use these tools. Let's use this technology to reach the lost with the gospel of Jesus Christ and the good news that, hey, he saved us. He redeemed us from the pit of hell. There's a gift waiting for us. Let's not let it go in vain. Amen. Listen, I call you blessed. We're going to show another video, and then Jeff will be right back. We'll be right back.
Evening, Cornerstone. My name's Jeff, and we got a lot to go through today, and let's just go to the Lord in prayer real quick. Father God, we thank you, Lord, for your great word. We thank you for the opportunity to be here to gather, even electronically, Lord. And what a great praise report of the people still receiving your healing touch and miracles by your hand, Lord. We give you glory and praise. Help us, Lord, and prepare our hearts. Help us to receive your word. Help me, Lord, to speak accurately. And we just give you praise, Lord. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Title of tonight is, Who Do You Say I Am? Matthew 16, 13 through 16 records some really interesting questions that Jesus asks his disciples. So if we look, Jesus comes to the region of Caesarea Philippi. He asks his disciples, who do people say I am? Interesting question. The answer is also kind of revealing too, because if you look at the answer in the next verse, well, they replied, some say John the Baptist, some say Elijah, others say Jeremiah or one of the other prophets. Interesting answer. As we keep going, he asks, but who do you say I am? And as we keep going, Simon Peter answers, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Of course, the correct answer. But the question I'm wondering is, why the varying answers? Why the different points of view? Maybe the answer is in the previous section of verses, 5 through 12. But we see that Jesus and the disciples are crossing to the other side of a lake. And the disciples realize they had forgotten to bring bread. Verse 6 of Matthew 16, Jesus warns them and says, watch out. Beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and Sadducees. And then in 7 through 11, they're arguing about who forgot the bread, and Jesus is trying to explain to them that that is not what he's talking about. But we get to verse 12, where the disciples finally understand that Jesus wasn't talking about the yeast that makes the bread rise or the leaven that makes the bread rise. He was talking about deceptive teachings of the Sadducees and the Pharisees. How interesting. He warns them, and then afterwards he's asking them who people say he is. So is it possible that religious leaders could be the reason that people don't know who Jesus really is? Because deceptive teachings lead to an improper view. I remember, what was it, 2012, I think there was a movie or a book called The Da Vinci Code. Was all about who Jesus was really supposed to be. I mean, I never watched it. I never read the book. I heard stuff about it, and it was preposterous, the thing that they were saying of Jesus. It was terrible. Now, people can be misled pretty easily, especially if we're not spending a lot of time in the Bible. We can, like, borderline be brainwashed, if you will, if we're not in our Bible guarding against false teachings. I'll prove it to you. I'll give you an example of how easy we can be tricked. Imagine you leave home. You jog a little ways, you turn left. You jog a little bit more, turn left. Jog some more, turn left again, and go back home. Like a square. Okay? But when you get home, you got a bunch of people yelling at you, and you got two stern-looking men in uniform waiting for you. Who are these men? Why is everybody yelling at you? Think about it for a minute. You curious? I'll go over it again. You leave your home. You jog a ways, you turn left. You jog a ways more, you turn left. You jog a ways more. Turn left and you go back home. You got people yelling at you. You got two stern-looking guys in uniform waiting for you. Did you give up? I got a picture that'll help unbrainwash you. Look at this. Now it all makes sense, doesn't it? Makes sense that the guys who were waiting for you weren't cops. Makes sense that the crowd yelling at you was the crowd in the stands. Makes all the difference when you have all the information, doesn't it? It just reveals how easily we can be misled. Deception leads to an improper view. Wording can be misleading. I had that whole thing, I worded that very carefully. Pictures can be misleading. Notice I didn't send you any pictures right away, so you wouldn't know what was going on. That's how easily we can be tricked. If we don't have all the information, if we're not studying our word, we can be easily misled just the same. So what's the point? Great question. Now look at Jesus' question again. Who do you say I am? Now, we're going to take another test. I'm going to throw up some pictures here. When I say Jesus, who do you immediately think about? Does he look like this? Is that what Jesus looks like? Or how about this one? Hard to see, I know, I'm sorry, but how about the next one? Does he look like this? Okay, actually a very good actor. Great portrayal in The Passion. Or how about this one? Wow. Is that our Jesus? Most pictures reflect a very soft, long-haired, almost pretty, if you will, feminine male. Sometimes only really recognizable by the fact he has a beard. That's sad to me, and it's kind of upsetting to me. But how could this be? The answer is simple. The church at large has failed to properly represent who Jesus is. But not only that, what he's taught, what he expects of us. And I praise God that that does not happen at this church. Our pastors, Pastor Bill, Pastor Matt, all the speakers here that I have sat under and listened to, very well-rounded, preaching the whole gospel and the whole word, and I praise God for that. A lot of growth. But gospel's been watered down in mainstream churches. Holiness and righteousness are words of a bygone era. Bulk of preaching about Jesus is almost solely focuses on his kindness, his love, and his mercy, which is incredibly important, and we need that terribly. But again, if you only present part of the gospel or part of God's word, you're missing half the picture. Of course, we can't also forget the most misquoted verse ever, "Judge not lest you be judged." Now, if you actually read the rest of that, it has a lot more to say. I'll let you guys do that. But deceptive teaching, we've got to be careful of this. Half-truth is a whole lie. It's no wonder, based on this, that people have such a misconstrued view of Jesus. It's my goal to fix this, to show us that we need to build our view of Jesus from his actual word, not from what everybody else says or from movies or anything like that. We got to get in his word. Because if we can continue in this scripture here, Matthew 16, 18, we're going to see that having a proper understanding of who Jesus is, the very foundation of the Christian church built by Jesus himself. Look what it says. "I say unto you that you are Peter," which means a rock, "and upon this rock I will build my church, and all the powers of hell will not conquer it." Now, we have two choices here. Either the church is built on Peter, or the church is built on Peter's confession that Jesus is the Christ, the Messiah, the Son of the living God. So who's the foundation of the church? Jesus or Peter? We only have two options here. But Paul makes this very clear that the foundation is Jesus. According to 1 Corinthians 3:11, says, "For no other foundation can anyone lay than that which has already been laid, which is Jesus Christ." So if we look at Peter's name, in the Greek it's Petros, which means a rock or a stone. Some other translations call it a pebble. It says his name's Pebble. The word rock, when Jesus says, "Upon this rock I will build my church," that word is Petra, which means solid rock. It can mean also bedrock. The church is built on the solid rock of Jesus Christ by means of the faith that Peter has shown in his confession that Jesus is Lord. Because we all come to Jesus by faith, confessing with our mouth that Jesus is Lord, and that God raised him from the dead. Romans 10:9, isn't that what Peter just did? But who do men say Jesus is? Church, we need to make sure we're getting our doctrines from God's word, solely from God's word, not from just what men say. I would encourage you not to just take my word for anything I'm saying, but go into your Bibles and verify. Make sure that what I'm saying lines up with God's word. Be diligent. Look at the Bereans in Acts 17:11. It says, they searched the scriptures day after day to make sure and to see if Paul and Silas were teaching them the truth. And we need to be doing the same. And we're not the only one. Jesus was not the only one's warning about deceptive teachings. If you look at 2 Timothy 4, 3-4, it says, for a time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but according to their own desires, because they have itching ears, and they'll heap up for themselves teachers, and they will turn their ears away from the truth and be turned to fables. Why? Because people don't want to hear the whole gospel. They don't want to hear all of this stuff. They want what they want. They have itching ears. They want a nice, easy, feel good, no repentance, Holy Spirit, just let me be happy, you know? Does that sound familiar? You know, like watered down gospel. This was a warning from Paul to Timothy, who was a young pastor. Acts 20:30 says, even some men from your own group will rise up and distort the truth in order to draw a following. This is a warning for people, for a pastor, of those in leadership to watch out for false prophets that come out of their own church, out of their own group. We need to be in the Word of God daily so this kind of stuff doesn't happen. John, 1 John 4:1 tells us, don't believe every spirit, test the spirits. It's important. I remember our church elder, Brother Chuck, did a message on testing the spirits. Phenomenal. And that is something we need to be doing. Titus 1:11. These false teachers must be silenced because they are turning whole families away from the truth by their false teachings. And they do it for money. Talks about silencing false teachers so they don't turn away families from the truth. This is why we got to be in the Word. So families, you know, can see, and if they know the Word of God, they can spot error. And they talked about why these false teachers do this, do it for money. 1 Timothy 6:3. Some people may contradict our teaching. This is Paul talking to Timothy. But these are wholesome teachings of the Lord Jesus Christ. These teachings promote a godly life. That people who are not truly the Lord's don't want anything to do with godliness, which is why they do stuff for gain. They do stuff to make money. 1 Timothy 6:5. So these people who contradict the wholesome teaching of Jesus, they cause trouble. Their minds are corrupt. They have turned their backs on the truth. And to them, a show of godliness is a way to become wealthy. We got to be aware of this. Now, again, this stuff doesn't happen here. I praise God. And I want to tell you, when I first came to this church, understanding where, if you guys know me, where I came from was a legalistic place. I came from legalism. Having faith and strong movements of the Holy Ghost was not something I was raised in. Okay, so when I first came to this church, it was right in the middle of Pastor Bill's Abundant Life series. And one thing I could not stand is people that just talk about money. Now, again, that does not happen here. But when I first came here, I didn't know that. So I was fired up because Pastor Bill was, you know, teaching about the abundant life. And I remember going up to him and saying, what are you, some kind of prosperity teacher? And he asked me just a couple simple questions and then told me to do something. And what he asked me is, he asked me if I was a father. And I said, well, yeah, I'm a dad. I got two kids. You already know that. He goes, well, do you want your kids to prosper? I'm like, yeah. You see where he's going with this? Because I didn't at the time. And he says, well, don't you think that our Heavenly Father wants that for us? And then he told me, why don't you go home and get in your Bible and look for yourself? And I did. So I compared Pastor Bill's words which was coming from Scripture, to Scripture itself, found out that the two matched, and I was completely wrong. Completely changed the way I looked at things. Because I had an improper view of God, because I wasn't in my Bible enough myself. And our pastor generously and nicely led me to do exactly what we're talking about today. I praise God. I praise God. Biblical teachings about Jesus will give the listener a proper perspective. On the other hand, false teachings will give them an improper view. For example, let's take that picture number 4, pop it back up there real quick. All this picture is with long hair. I'm just doing this for an example, okay? It's long hair. Is that accurate? Let's just take the long hair, okay? Does Jesus have long hair? Well, it always shows him with long brown hair for some reason. Is his hair brown? Is it long? Most Middle Eastern people that I have met, because I meet a lot of people in my job, most of them have black hair, not brown. But anyways, I'm going to show you again how I think this is an inaccurate picture. Most would seem to think that he has long hair because he was a Nazarene. Okay, Matthew 2:23 says, he will be called a Nazarene. Now, they automatically assume because he's a Nazarene, he must have taken the Nazarite vow. Now, it doesn't make any sense. For one, the two have really nothing to do with each other. Nazarene, spelled N-A-Z-A-R-E-N-E. Nazarite vow, spelled N-A-Z-I-R-I-T. One is a place of dwelling. One is a specific name of a vow. The two really don't have anything to do with each other. But let's just look at the rules of what the Nazarite vow is. Numbers 6, 3 through 4. Okay, so they, those who are taking this Nazarite vow, they must give up wine, other alcoholic drinks. They must not use vinegar made from wine or from other alcoholic drinks. They must not drink fresh grape juice. They must not eat grapes or raisins, as we keep reading. As long as they are bound by the Nazarite vow, they are not allowed to eat or drink anything that comes from a grapevine. Not even the seeds or the skin. So no raisins either. Verse 5. They must never cut their hair throughout the time of their vow. Okay, so that's where they get the long hair, possibly. Okay. And verse 6. What does verse 6 say? It's the third rule. They must not go near a dead body. Okay, so let's just say we know here that there's three laws, right, to this vow. So if Jesus breaks just one of them, that automatically disqualifies him. That means if he broke one, he failed, right? Well, we know Jesus is no failure. Okay, we already know that. But the first two laws, the first two rules, no raisins, no fresh grape juice, no wine. Okay, we can make an argument either way on that. It's not definitive, in my view. Doesn't say anything about his hair in Scripture either, though there is a verse that says, isn't it a disgrace for a man to have long hair? That's in 1 or 2 Corinthians. I don't remember. But anyways, I digress from those. But we're going to look specifically at Rule 3. Do not go near a dead body. Well, Luke 7:14 says, walked over to a coffin and touched it. He's pretty near a dead body if he's touching a coffin. And he says, young man, I tell you, get up. Okay, I'll get you. I'll give you one more. Mark 5:41. Holding her hand, he said to her, Talithakum, which means little girl, get up. This is Jairus' daughter who had already died. So he is grabbing a dead young girl's hand. I would say, just off those two examples, he broke rule number 3. Oops. So by observation and just a little bit of checking, first two vows not clearly stated, but third one, clearly it was broken. So it would only matter if Jesus actually took this vow, which I would say he didn't, because Jesus does not sin. 1 Peter 1:19 said he is sinless, spotless, Lamb of God. John 1:29 says the reason why this sinless, spotless Lamb of God came. Take away the sins of the world. He didn't come here to sin, and he didn't. He's perfect. spotless. Word says that over and over. So did he take this vow? Doubt it. Don't think so, because he wouldn't break any rules, because he's perfect. Plus, the Bible doesn't say anything about him taking this vow. So just by, again, observation, a little bit of study, some deductive reasoning, he couldn't have taken it. So the Jesus with long hair, probably unlikely. But anyways, I digress. What is the Jesus we should be imagining? Was he feminine? I doubt that. I doubt that very seriously. A lot of these pictures show him as a very soft, you know, it's frustrating, frustratingly, you know, a weakling is what he looks like. I'm sorry, but that's the way I see it in myself. But what does Scripture say? Isaiah 53:2. Let's see what it says. He shall grow up before him as a tender plant, as a root out of the dry ground. He has no form or comeliness, and when we see him, there's no beauty that we should desire him. So is he like super handsome? That's not what this says. Look at the New Living Translation version of it. There was nothing beautiful or majestic about his appearance, nothing to attract us to him. So this fair-skinned, super handsome Jesus, it's not according to this. He had none of that, we would be physically attracted to him. Mark 6:3 tells us that he was a carpenter. Okay, what do you know about carpenters? Carpenters work with wood, they build things, they work with stone. There's a lot of physical activity. So I would imagine he's probably relatively strong with doing, if you're doing a lot of hand sawing and a lot of wood, you know, doing all this stuff, you know, you're building strength there. So for having him looking all weakling like most of these pictures, I don't think that's true. John 19:1-3. Okay, look at this. Pilate scourged him. Then the soldiers twisted a crown of thorns and put it on his head. And then they beat him. Okay, so he's been scourged. He's had a crown of thorns on his head, and he's been physically beaten afterwards. Look at what verse 17 says. Carried the cross by himself. Okay, that to me, after being beaten like that, I wouldn't be going anywhere. I'd be still laying on the ground. Jesus carries his own cross. I imagine he's probably very strong due to his life. Okay, so I think he's much more manly than the pictures depict. But that's enough about his look. Who is he? Yes, he is our Savior. He's our Comforter, the Prince of Peace. The Bible has a lot to say about who he is. We already know the nice side of things, but that's all that most preachers ever talk about. Jesus is all we need. He does plan to do us good. He does want to bless us. He does want to prosper us. All these are true. What's often omitted is the fact that these things that Jesus wants to do are a direct result of our relationship, trust, and obedience to him. Let's talk about some of the things that seem to get left out. Colossians, this is Jesus' supremacy over everything, and it's amazing. Colossians 1:15-18, Christ is the visible image of the invisible God. So when you see Jesus, you are seeing God the Father. He is the exact image of God the Father. He existed before everything was created. Okay, so there are other religions out there that say, like, Jesus is, you know, a created being. This is simply not true. Word says he existed before everything was created. And he is supreme over all creation. For through Jesus, God created everything in the heavenly realms and on earth. He made the things we can see, the things we can't see, again, such as thrones, kingdoms, rulers, and authorities in the unseen world. Everything was created through him and for him. Everything's for Jesus, and he is supreme over everything. Verse 17, he existed before anything else, and he holds all of creation together. Jesus himself holds everything together. If you do a little bit of biology and get into that, it's amazing why our bodies are even together. They're only together because Jesus decided it and wills it, and he holds it together himself. Christ is the head of the church, which is the body. He is the beginning, supreme over all who arise from the dead. So he is first in everything. What about Jesus as the judge? Nobody wants to think about that at all. Because if our Lord Jesus is going to be judged, that means we're going to be accountable. And those who are not saved are going to be accountable. Acts 10:42 tells us Jesus is the one appointed by God to judge all, the living and the dead. 2 Timothy 4:8 says Jesus is the righteous judge. Romans 2:16 says God, through Jesus Christ, will judge everyone's secret life. Yikes. 2 Corinthians 5:10 tells us that we all must stand before Christ to have our works judged. Okay, the judgment seat of Christ, everything that we've done in this earthly body, okay? There's a lot of scriptures that we could go over here, but you get the idea. One day we will live, or we need to live in the light of these truths. You know, the lost are going to face the great white throne judgment and face Jesus as their judge there for everything that they've done. We, as the saved, will have our works looked at and judged by Jesus to see whether they were done for him or done for us. I remember telling Pastor Bill once, you know, I'm not crazy about that because, you know, I have stood before churches and done some preaching and taught youth and stuff like that. But I know in me, I did that for me. You know, I did it wrong. And, you know, I talked to Pastor Bill about this and I said, I just want to make him happy now. I don't, you know, I did it for the wrong reasons before. I am trying to live in the light of that Jesus will see my works. And I'm praying that that I have something left there and that my whole life don't burn up in front of me, you know? We need to live in the light of that. So what about Jesus being the Lord of our life? You know, let's be real here, church. We can blow it real easy here. We already know that Jesus is supreme over all and he will, you know, be judging our works. But we confess that Jesus is Lord according to Romans 10:9. That's how we became saved. We confess Jesus is Lord with our mouth. But listen to what some stuff he says about his lordship. Luke 6:46. Why do you keep calling me Lord, Lord, when you don't do what I say? You know, I can understand that because I don't always do what Jesus tells me to do, you know? Either he is my Lord and the Lord of my life and I am totally submitted to him or I am not. And, you know, that's something that thank God he is working in me, you know, and I'm hopefully going down the right road. I pray that I am. Matthew 7:21-23. I told Pastor Bill this is the scariest verse in the Bible. This group right here. Not everyone who calls out to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. Only those who actually do the will of my Father in heaven, those are the ones that are going to enter. Verse 22 says, on judgment day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, we prophesied in your name and cast out demons in your name and performed many miracles in your name. Verse 23, this is Jesus talking again. I will say to you, I never knew you. Get away from me, you who break God's laws. You know, look at 22 again. These people were prophesying in Jesus' name, casting out demons in Jesus' name, and performing many miracles in Jesus' name. And they still missed it. Why? Because they weren't doing the will of the Father. And like I said, I told Pastor Bill, it scares me. You know, I don't want to get up there and realize that I had done everything for the wrong reasons. You know, I want to be doing God's will. And that's finally my goal. Thank God. Matthew 10:33 says, whoever denies me before men, will I deny before my Father in heaven. This, to me, relates to, you know, when we witness. You know, a lot of times we don't witness because we're afraid of rejection. Or it could also mean, you know, somebody says, hey, what are you, a Christian? Put a gun to your head, and you're like, nope, I'm not. You know, what happens then? You know, you're denying him. We don't want to do that. Matthew 10, 37. This one's rough to me. He who loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. He who loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. Keep going. And he who does not take his cross and follow after me is not worthy of me. That, to me, it's heavy. But Luke expands on this even more. Let's look at what Luke says. Parallel passage to this. If anyone comes to me and does not hate his father, mother, wife, and children, brothers and sisters, yes, and his own life also, he cannot be my disciple. Now, does that mean that we're supposed to hate our family? No, of course not. We're talking, are they more important? Do you love them more than Jesus? Are your family, your spouse, your kids on the throne of your life? That's what we're talking about here. Let's keep going. Whoever does not bear this cross and come after me can't be to my disciple. So you're telling me that nothing and no one is to occupy the throne of our hearts but Jesus. Yes, he's supposed to be the top. He's supposed to be Lord. What is a Lord? Lord is the one who tells you what to do. He's the one that owns you. That's what a Lord is. He's telling us that if anyone has more value than he, more value to us than he is, then we're not worthy of him. That's harsh, hard, but you know what? It's right. Because of the great things that Jesus has done for us, we should be having him as Lord of our life, number one. We submit ourselves because of what he's done. He takes his lordship serious. Makes it inescapably clear. I mean, if you want, read Matthew 25, the parable of the virgins, the parable of the talents, the separating of the sheep of the goats. I mean, Jesus is Lord of your life. It's big. It's big. You know, I can't say that I always make decisions based on, you know, what God tells me. Sometimes I'm blowing it, you know. He's not interested in part-time disciples, though. You know, he wants all of us, all the time. You know, even in the little things, he wants to be involved in every aspect of our lives. You know, he's not interested in lukewarm Christians. You know what the Bible says about that. He's going to spit you out of your mouth if you're lukewarm. He doesn't want that. He wants all of us. You know? Have we counted the cost? You know? Are we totally committed? I know not too long ago I wasn't anywhere near this that I'm doing today because Jesus wasn't Lord. You know, I was away from that. But you know, praise God, he's working in my life, you know. And it's an ongoing thing. Romans 6:1, you know, Jesus expects us and commands us to stop sinning. You know, that's not popular either. I know you might be saying, Jeff, come on, we're under grace here. But Romans 6:1 says, shall we keep sinning or continue to sin that grace may abound? Certainly not. Of course not. No, we're not supposed to keep sinning. That's Paul. But this is what Jesus says. Look at this. John 5 talks about Jesus healing a man at the pool of Bethesda who had been sick for 38 years. Look what Jesus tells him in verse 14. After Jesus heals him, says, Jesus found him in the temple and told him, now you're well, so stop sinning or something even worse may happen to you. Jesus expects us to live like his children. We are to be doing God the Father's will. And obviously, God does not want us to keep purposefully sinning. Okay? John 8 3 through 11 records the story of the woman caught in the very act of adultery. Look what Jesus says to her, verse 11. Who condemns you, he asked. He goes, no one, Lord. And Jesus said to her, neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more. Again, Jesus is not wanting us to keep purposely, willfully sinning. Of course, you know, there are going to be times when we make mistakes, but, you know, praise God for repentance, which Jesus himself preached. Of course, repentance isn't a popular topic either. But Matthew 4:17 says from Jesus, repent, for the kingdom of God is, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. What is, okay, what's repentance? That is, you know, turning away from what you're doing. That is agreeing with God, is what repentance is, agreeing with God. Okay, this is wrong, and you stop doing it. That is repentance, turning away and, you know, stop doing it. Luke 13:3 says, again, repent, or you all likewise perish. Verse 5 says the same thing. Unless you repent, you'll all likewise perish. So repentance is very important to Jesus and to us, because that's when we sin, even accidentally or purposefully, it gets us out of God's will. It's our sin separates us. Repentance brings us back to him. We got to be doing this. You know, Matthew 23, I mean, Jesus condemns religious elites for the hypocrisy. I mean, it's harsh. He repeatedly says to him, woe to you, you hypocrites, you fools, you blind guides. You know, he's calling these people out because they're rebellious. And, but, you know, he prays God for the space for repentance, you know, his mercy, restoration, when we submit ourselves. Matthew 23:11, listen to this. Greatest among you should be your servant. You know, it's not popular. A lot of people like the titles. You know, when I was doing this, that was one of my biggest problems. I liked the idea of being called a youth pastor, the title. But if we're going to be really like Jesus, we should be serving. How about, let's see, Luke 6, where Jesus says, verse 27-28, love your enemies, do good to those who hate you. Now, you know, even in our modern world, are we, you know, is that something that's happening out here? No, it ain't. It's like eye for an eye out here, you know. Somebody does something bad to me, you do it back, or do it worse. You know, this is not popular. We are to love our enemies, do good to those who hate us, bless those that curse you, pray for those who use you. Look at verse 30. Give to anyone who asks of you. Ooh. Not popular there, is it? Anyone who asks, give to them. Verse 42. How can you say to your brother, let me remove a speck from your eye, when you can't see the beam in your own eye? Hypocrite. First, remove the beam out of your own eye, and then help your brother get the speck out of his. I mean, these are all things that... you know, we can easily do. I mean, I know I can probably at some time or another be guilty of most all of these things, you know. But praise God for his word, because his word changes me. Listening to his word, being under a man of God who accurately and completely preaches the word, changes people's lives. Okay, God's word is alive. You know, I could go on and on. The church, do you know him? Who is Jesus to you? In closing, I know some of this was kind of heavy, maybe direct, but if we're not preaching the whole scripture, then we're seriously doing a disservice. Understand that not everything in God's word is happy and go-lucky and glitter, because the business of heaven is serious. You know, heaven and hell, that's serious business. You know, Jesus said so much more that can be covered in a single service. He spoke much about the kingdom of heaven. I'm just trying to convey the importance of us to, you know, get in the word, you know, so we are accurate, so we can, you know, not be tripped up by false teachings. So we are being transformed by God's word. That's the important part, you know. I want to leave you with the only two physical descriptions of Jesus I could find. They're both in the book of Revelation. But if you want to, look at this picture and then listen to what the Revelation says about the King of Kings and see if this picture and this description match. Standing in the middle of the lampstand was someone like the Son of Man. He was wearing a long robe and a golden sash across his chest. His hair and his head were like white, like wool, white as snow. His eyes were like flames of fire. His feet like polished bronze refined in a furnace. And his voice thundered like mighty ocean waves. He held seven stars in his right hand, and a sharp two-edged sword came out of his mouth. And his face was like the sun in all of its brilliance. Revelation 19:11 through 16 says, "When I saw heaven open, a white horse was standing there, and its rider's name was Faithful and True, for he judges fairly and wages a righteous war. His eyes were like flames of fire, and his head were many crowns, a name written on him that no one understood except for himself. He wore a robe dipped in blood, and his title was the Word of God. The armies of heaven, dressed in the finest of pure white linen, followed him on white horses, and from his mouth came a sharp sword to strike down the nations. He will rule them with a rod of iron. He will release the fierce wrath of God Almighty, like the juices flowing from a winepress. And on his robe, at his thigh, was written this title, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords." Does that look right to you, church? Jesus is asking us, who do you say I am? Am I the Lord of your life? So let's stop riding the coattails of other people's, you know, studying and everything like that. Let's get into our Bibles and meet Jesus for ourselves. So when he asks us, who do you say I am? We can be confident by saying, you are my Lord, the Son of the living God, the Anointed One. You receive that today. Praise God. Father God, we give you glory and we praise your great name. Lord, because you are a soon returning King, come and let back soon, Lord. And we look forward. We look forward to seeing you come. Lord, help us to rightly divide your word. Help us, Lord, to be absorbing your word and being our Bibles daily. Lord, so that if asked, Lord, who you are, Lord, we can accurately tell a lost and dying world about the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords and the one who died to save them. Father God, we give you glory, we give you praise, and we thank you for your goodness. In Jesus' name, amen. And as Pastor Bill would say, I call you blessed.